Hello friends, welcome to the session on oscillators. In this session, we'll be discussing about Colpitts oscillator. In this session, we will see the circuit diagram of Colpitts oscillator. We will see the working of Colpitts oscillator. And also, we will analyze the circuit to obtain the expression for frequency and condition for oscillations. Friends, as you know that you are viewing this session on my YouTube channel, Learn with Prakash Kanade. And do subscribe to the channel to see many more videos on the subjects of electronics and computer science. So let us start the session with what we mean by the Colpitts oscillator. Friends, we know that Colpitts oscillator or any oscillator is an electronic circuit that will generate the AC output. Oscillator will not have any AC input, and still it is possible to generate the AC output at the oscillator. So oscillator circuit is a generator circuit. It can be called as a signal generator circuit. Colpitts oscillator is also an electronic circuit in which the frequency of oscillations will be determined by the components that are used in the tuned circuit of the Colpitts oscillator. So Colpitts oscillator is one of the LC oscillator in which we need to make the use of the tuned circuit, which consists of inductor and capacitor. So the frequency of oscillations will be decided by the inductor and the capacitors that are used in the tuned circuit of the Colpitts oscillator. Colpitts oscillator was originally invented by the American scientist E.H. Colpitts in 1918, and that is the reason his name is being given to this oscillator. Colpitts oscillator will consist of a LC tuned circuit as a feedback circuit, and in this feedback circuit, it will make the use of one inductor and two capacitors. As we have seen earlier in case of Hartley oscillator, that in Hartley oscillator, we need to make use of two inductors and one capacitor. But in Colpitts oscillator, we need to make use of one inductor and two capacitors. The tuned circuit that is being used in the Colpitts oscillator works as a feedback circuit. Just like the Hartley oscillator, Colpitts oscillator is also a high frequency oscillator. And by using this oscillator, it is possible that we can generate a signal of several kilohertz, or even sometimes up to megahertz, the frequency can be generated by using the Colpitts oscillator. Colpitts oscillator can also be used as a radio frequency oscillator, and we can generate the frequencies in the range of 20 kilohertz to about 30 megahertz by using Colpitts oscillator. It is possible that we can construct the Colpitts oscillator by using transistor amplifier, or you can make the use of operational amplifier for the construction of the Colpitts oscillator. We know that every oscillator basically contains an amplifier, and therefore we need either a transistor amplifier or operational amplifier in the circuit of the Colpitts oscillator. Now we must note that the low frequency oscillations cannot be generated by using this oscillator, because this is the LC oscillator. And in case of LC oscillator, the components that we are using, that is the inductor and capacitor, they are of very low value. And in the frequency expression, we will observe that is L and C appears in the denominator. Since the values of L and C are very small, low frequency oscillations cannot be generated by making the use of Hartley oscillator or Colpitts oscillator. If you want to generate low frequency oscillations, then you need to go for the use of RC oscillators. This oscillator has a wide range of applications. Say, for example, in radio receiver, this oscillator can be used. Apart from radio receiver, television receiver, radar receiver, radio transmitter can also make the use of such oscillator. The oscillations that are generated at the output of the Colpitts oscillator are sinusoidal in nature. That is, the shape of the oscillations is of sine wave. Now let us go for the circuit diagram of Colpitts oscillator. As we know that in any oscillator, what we need is basically an amplifier and a feedback circuit. So as shown in this circuit diagram, the Colpitts oscillator will consist of a transistor amplifier, which is CE amplifier. And the output of the amplifier is coupled to a feedback circuit. The feedback circuit used is the tuned circuit, which consists of two capacitors C1 and C2 and one inductor. Output of the feedback circuit is coupled back to the input of the amplifier through the coupling capacitor. observe that the resistances R1, R2, RC, RE are the biasing resistances which are used to set the bias of the transistor. Circuit diagram for the Colpitts oscillator is shown in the figure, and it consists of a common emitter amplifier and a feedback circuit, which is a tuned circuit. So the LC tuned circuit will consist of the inductor L and the capacitor C1 and C2. So the only difference between Hartley oscillator and Colpitts oscillator is that in case of Hartley oscillator, we use two inductors and one capacitor. But in case of Colpitts oscillator, we use two capacitors and one inductor. The output of the amplifier is coupled back to the feedback circuit, and the output of the feedback circuit is again connected back to the input of the amplifier. Resistances that are used in the circuit are the biasing resistances, which will set the appropriate bias to the transistor so that the transistor will work as an amplifier. Coupling capacitors are used to couple only the AC voltage, and they used to block the DC voltages. So only AC signal is coupled through the coupling capacitor. Coupling capacitors are used at the input of the amplifier and at the output of the amplifier. Now let us see how the Colpitts oscillator work in order to generate the oscillations. As we know that every oscillator will require some starting voltage, and this starting voltage is being provided by the noise signal that is present at the input of the oscillator circuit. Since there is no input actually connected to the circuit, the noise signal is there, and this noise signal is being used as the starting voltage for the generation of oscillations. Amplifier will amplify this noise signal, and it will provide a phase shift of 180 degrees to all the frequencies that are present at the input. Output of the amplifier will be connected to the feedback circuit. The feedback circuit will provide an additional phase shift of 180 degrees. But this phase shift will be provided only for one particular frequency, and which is the resonant frequency of the tuned circuit. And therefore, you will find that for this frequency, the condition for positive feedback is being achieved. That is, the amplifier will provide a 180 degree phase shift, and the feedback circuit will provide an additional 180 degree phase shift. So there will be a total 360 degree phase shift. And when the Barkhausen condition A beta is equal to 1 is satisfied, that is when the product of the voltage gain and the feedback ratio of the amplifier is equal to 1, then the sustained oscillations can be generated at the output of the Colpitts oscillator. The frequency of oscillation in any oscillator will not depend upon the amplifier, but it will depend upon the components that are used in the feedback circuit. Say, for example, the inductor L and the capacitor C1 and C2 will decide the frequency of oscillations. Now we can analyze the circuit of the Colpitts oscillator in order to obtain the expression for frequency of oscillation and condition for oscillation. Now suppose that this is an amplifier which is being replaced by the voltage source AV into VI with output resistance RO. The capacitors C1 and C2 are replaced by the impedances Z1 and Z2, and the inductor L is replaced by the impedance Z3. The output of the amplifier is coupled to the feedback circuit, and the output of the feedback circuit VF is coupled back to the input of the amplifier. So from the figure, we can easily observe that the feedback voltage VF is just nothing but beta times VO, where beta can be defined as Z1 divided by Z1 plus Z3 into VO. Since beta is the feedback ratio, and output VF is obtained across Z1. Therefore, beta can be defined as Z1 divided by Z1 plus Z3. The total impedance of the parallel circuit or tuned circuit can be given as Zp is equal to Z2 parallel Z1 plus Z3. So this is just nothing but R1 parallel R2, means R1 into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. And therefore, Zp can be written as Z2 into Z1 plus Z3 divided by Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. Now we can redraw, or we can simplify, the equivalent circuit for the oscillator. Suppose this is the voltage source minus AV into VI. This is the output resistance RO, and the tuned circuit is replaced by ZP. And suppose the current that is being flowing through the circuit is IO. Now we can write this current IO is equal to minus AV into VI divided by RO plus ZP. So this is just nothing but VO divided by ZP. or we can write VO divided by VI is equal to minus AV into ZP divided by RO plus ZP. And therefore, we can get the expression for the gain of the amplifier. A is equal to VO divided by VI, which is just nothing but minus AV into. Now we will replace this ZP by using this value Z2 into Z1 plus Z3 divided by Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3. And therefore, we can rewrite this equation as A is equal to minus AV into Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z3 divided by RO into Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3 plus Z2 into Z1 plus Z3. Now we can obtain the expression for the loop gain. The loop gain can be written as A into beta. And this is just nothing but minus AV into Z1, Z2 divided by RO in the bracket Z1 plus Z2 plus Z3 plus Z2 into Z1 plus Z3. Now we know that Z1 is just nothing but JX1, Z2 is just nothing but JX2, and Z3 is just nothing but JX3. And therefore, we can write the product of loop gain A beta is equal to AV into X1, X2 divided by JRO in the bracket X1 plus X2 plus X3 minus X2 in the bracket X1 plus X3. Now, we want the loop gain to be real. If the loop gain has to be real, then the imaginary component in the above expression must be equal to zero. This is possible only when X1 plus X2 plus X3 is equal to zero. Now this indicates that the one reactance must be negative and the reactances X1 and X2 must be of the same type and X3 must be of opposite type. And therefore we can rewrite the above equation A beta is equal to minus AV into X1 divided by X1 plus X3 because we have substituted the imaginary term equal to zero. But the same can be written as AV into X1 divided by X2 because X1 plus X3 is just nothing but minus X2. Now we know that for the Barkhausen condition to be satisfied for an oscillator, the loop gain A beta must be equal to 1. And therefore, when we equate the above expression equal to 1, we can have the AV is equal to, that is the gain of the amplifier, AV is equal to X2 divided by X1. You will find that the analysis up to this stage is almost same to that of Hartley oscillator. So as far as the analysis of Hartley and Colpitts oscillator is concerned, there is no difference up to many steps. Now only the difference will occur in the next slide where you will find that we will substitute the values of X1 and X2. Now in order to obtain the condition for oscillation, what we will have to do is that we have to substitute the values of X1, X2 and X3. We know that X1 is equal to the reactance of capacitor C1 and therefore it can be written as minus 1 upon omega C1. X2 can be written as minus 1 upon omega C2 and X3 is the reactance of the inductor L which can be written as omega L. And therefore we can obtain the condition for oscillation AV is equal to X2 divided by X1 which is just nothing but omega C1 divided by omega C2 which is just nothing but C1 divided by C2. So this is the condition for oscillation. That is the gain of the amplifier must be equal to the ratio of capacitances C1 and C2. So whenever you want to construct a Colpitts oscillator, while selecting the capacitor C1 and C2, you need to take care that this condition is being satisfied. Now we can go for the frequency of oscillation. The frequency of oscillation can be obtained by using the expression X1 plus X2 plus X3 is equal to zero. That is minus one upon omega C1 minus one upon omega C2 plus omega L is equal to zero. That is 1 upon omega C1 plus 1 upon omega C2 is equal to omega L. That is 1 upon C1 plus 1 upon C2 is equal to omega square L. Therefore, omega square is equal to 1 upon L in the bracket 1 upon C1 plus 1 upon C2. So this is just nothing but 1 upon L CT. So we have replaced the total capacitance as CT. And therefore, omega can be written as 1 upon under root L CT. And therefore the frequency f can be written as f is equal to 1 upon 2 pi under root L CT, where CT is just nothing but C1 into C2 divided by C1 plus C2. So this is the expression for frequency of oscillation of Colpitts oscillator. From this expression, we can easily observe that the inductor and the capacitor appears in the denominator. Also, the frequency of oscillation will only depend upon the inductor and the capacitor C1 and C2 used in the circuit. Thank you, friends, for viewing the session. Hopefully, you have understood the working and analysis of the Colpitts oscillator. Thank you all for viewing the session.